current scenario. So that this becomes the DNS being a part and parcel of this particular cyber space. So any attack on this becomes very apt and important, and it will have a multiplying factor. So I think it will be a good technical learning for all of us. And I request Balaji to start his presentation. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thanks a lot. So once again, welcome to all of you. And I would also want you to welcome you to the DNS COE community that we are trying to create in this country. So this has been an effort which has been funded by Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology as well as NICSI, National Internet Exchange of India. So they have been supporting us. And of course, ICANN India and other industry partners are also supporting us, and we have been part of them through various forums. So I think let us start with this new beginning, and we will keep you communicating throughout whatever the developments that we are having to, and we'll start this particular session. So this first session is going to give us the basics of the DNS infrastructure, and the objective. Yeah, the agenda is basically to cover the basics and the architecture of the DNS system, and we will look into the forward and backward resolution. How is it happening? So. So when you type URL in your browser, but of course, let me just interrupt for a moment before I start. I just want to inform all of you that if you have any questions, actually, please raise your hand. That is available in the participant. You can see the participant. If you click on the participant link, if you want to ask a question or interrupt, please feel free to raise your hand, and we will go ahead with that. Okay. So right now. Let me start again with the session. So when you type a website name or a URL in your browser, and let us say that you are typing our same coedns.security.in. So what is that which happens is shown here. So here, as you can see, it just starts with all with the application layer. Okay. So in the application layer, if based on the port HTTP or HTTPS, the next layer gets into picture, that is TCP. The TCP port will be designated as 80 for HTTP and 443 for HTTPS. And the source port, that is your machine's port, will be whatever the number is there. And then the next subsequent layer, network layer, has to contain the following information. The predominantly this following information, that is the source IP and the destination IP. Source IP is nothing but the machine from where you are requesting. Basically, it will be your proxy or something like that. Destination IP will be the IP address of coedns.security.in. So now how do you get this address is the biggest question. So for that, you require another application service, which is called as a DNS. Like HTTP is one of the application layer protocol. DNS is also a application layer protocol. Okay. So this is how it actually works out. So now when you use the DNS protocol for querying the this thing, so it will give you the following response. Suppose we are querying what is the IP address for www.crack.in, then probably you get the following IP address. And if you are querying for a IPv6 address, so this is what you'll be getting us. And similarly, you can get a reverse translation is also possible. That is, if you are giving an IP address, you'll be able to get the domain name. And if you are trying to give the IPv6 address, then obviously you are being able to get the domain name. So we'll get back to that in a moment of time. So basically, as I said to you, that DNS is a application layer protocol. So in the network protocol layer stack that everybody would be familiar with, so DNS falls in the upper layer, that is application layer protocol. So many of the other applications like HTTP is also an application layer protocol, like your IMAP and SMTP, all those things are also application layer protocols. They in turn use the DNS for resolving a domain name to an IP address. Okay, So, and DNS actually in turn uses the UDP protocol for queries and responses. Please note it actually, this actually DNS uses UDP protocol for queries and responses. TCP it uses, but that is only between DNS server to DNS server communication. That is between two DNS servers, which one is acting as a master and another as a slave, then they will use TCP. Otherwise, it's largely, otherwise it is only a UDP based protocol which actually happens. So as I said to you that HTTP protocol, FTP, SMTP, all those protocols use this UDP protocol for name resolution. And most important thing is that there is no single server in this world that has all the mappings for all the host internet. So what this means is the data is totally distributed across the world. So for example, for converting the COE DNS security.in to a given IP address, you cannot go to one single server and tell me what is the address and you will not be able to get. Actually, the traversal has to happen across many servers and then you will be able to get the data. So this is how the DNS has been designed. So let us get into that particular thing. So what actually DNS provides us is, it provides you us with a consistent hierarchical namespace for referring to resources. Okay, so it's basically a tree-based structure. And in a tree-based structure, you know that nodes at the same level cannot have same names, okay? Because the sisters cannot or brothers cannot have the same name, so they should have a different name. And then basically, of course, DNS forms the critical component of the internet infrastructure, and the database, whatever the data is, globally distributed, and it's a very scalable mechanism and a reliable database. So this is what is there as far as DNS is concerned. And this is a decentralized naming system. Like there is nobody who dictates from the top that this should be your name, nothing like that. So there is a decentralized naming system. That is, you have some freedom to choose the name for your domain. So that is why we call it as a decentralized naming system. And the administration of DNS is shared. There is no single central entity is existing to administer all the DNS data. Since there is no single central server holds all of the data, there is no single entity to control the data also. So actually, this is all done by different nodes at different levels in the hierarchical tree structure. So this distribution of administration is called delegation. Okay. So this is one of the interesting concepts of distributed computing that we can see here. Now, generally coming to the structure of the DNS, it looks like this. You can see that the top there you have a root node, and followed by that you have TLDs, top level domains. So there are top level domains, there are country specific TLDs are there, like .in, in stands for India. So similarly, there are countries like US, UK. So all the countries in the world have a two character top level domain, TLDs. We call that a CCTLDs, country code top level domains. And also you have a generic TLDs like .org, .net, .com, etc. And under the .in domain, you can have, of course, that particular entity can have multiple subdomains. Say you can have ac.in, that is for in India, you have academic subdomain, that is STLD. So ac.in actually has multiple other subdomains, like all the universities, NIT, whatever the universities are there. Similarly, if you are an organization like, or if you are trying to have a project effort like COE DNS security, then you can directly register under .in and you can directly operate it. So like you can see that google.com comes under .com and mail.google.com is totally administered by google.com. So this is how this thing. So this hierarchy can go much further, several levels down. So TLDs, STLDs, and subdomains are all available here, okay? So now, next, let us see how the DNS is working. So as we saw in the beginning of the slide, your browser or a DNS client actually asks for the IP address for a www.cnac.in or whatever website it is for. And then that query goes to the local DNS server or the resolver, we say. So there are multiple types of DNS servers. We will tell you how to differentiate between them. And right now we'll assume that the query is going from a DNS client to a DNS server, which we are calling as a resolver. Now, this resolver is generally operated by your ISP, whoever is providing you the internet connection. So they will be operating it. Or you can also use other public resolvers like which has been operated by Google 8.8.8.8, right, or something, or 1.1.1 by Anycast and things like that. And of course, CDAC, of course, as part of this project, we are also having a public DNS resolver, which we will share it with you a little later. So now the query will go to a DNS resolver, and the DNS resolver will first check its cache. So if it is in the corresponding IP address, if it is there available for this particular domain, if it is available in the cache, then obviously you will get the result immediately. Otherwise, what will happen is basically you will the DNS server will send a query to the root DNS server. Okay, so we call it as a root DNS name server. That I just want to highlight that word, root DNS name server. So there it will ask what is the IP address of www.cdac.in. Okay, so now root name server will say that I don't know the address of cdac.in name server, but you can directly go and ask someone that is dot in name server. So root DNS server is saying that it will not reply directly what is the IP address of cdac.in because it does not have the answer, but it has with it the address of the dot in DNS name server. So it will say that you go and check with dot in name server and where you can try to get the answer. That's what root DNS replies. So but root DNS just directly replies with the IP address of dot in tld name server. So this is what is happening. So your resolver then will make a query to dot in tld DNS name server, and then dot in will say that this will give you an IP address which will say that this is the authoritative name server for cdac.in. That is basically what it will say is it will tell you the IP address of the server from where you can go and fetch the actual write record for the cdac.in domain name. So basically dot in will respond with the name server for cdac.in. So you actually go and ask the cdac.in name server what is the IP address for cdac.in. So that will give you the authoritative answer. Okay, so just you have to remember that for any given domain name, let us say coedns.security.in or cdac.in or whatever domain name, there is going to be one authoritative name server, at least one. Okay, there can be many authoritative name servers, but at least there is going to be one authoritative name server which is supposed to give the right answer for that particular domain. Okay, so now that particular authoritative name server is what that will be stored in the upper level, that is upper layer. So basically in the case of cdac.in, the IP address of the authoritative name server, let me repeat it, the IP address of the authoritative name server will be stored in the .in domain. So similarly, the IP address of .in, authoritative IP address name server for .in will be stored in the root. So this is how it keeps going. Okay, so these are the elements of DNS. Basically, DNS consists of the domain namespace and the resource records. And basically, a domain namespace is a tree structure based one and data associated with this one. I'm just seeing one hand raised up. Let me unmute. Yes, Mr. Abhijit.
Yeah, hello, sir. Sir, sometime when we do NS lookup, we see authoritative name authoritative and sometimes we see non-authoritative. Sir, what is the difference between those two, sir?
Okay. So So basically when you say authoritative, what it means is that is going to give the right response. The rest of the servers would be a cached response. They are not the authoritative sources, but they will have the data with them. Okay, either by caching or by other they operate. Basically what happens is the DNS name servers are the operated by not by the domain owner. So for example, coedns.security.in is basically a domain that we are operating. Actually we are operating the website, but we don't operate the name server for that. Name servers are typically operated by separate DNS service providers. Okay, so they will actually have the run the authoritative name servers for us. Okay, so this is how it happens. And sometimes this domain name to IP address translation will be cached by other servers also. We can say them as again secondary servers or something like that, but they are not authoritative. So that is the thing that you will be getting. Okay.
So is there any method to refresh the cached data? Let's say like today some domain and like today some URL IP address gets changed, but the DNS server is still maintaining like details from its cache. So of course we will not get served by the URL, right? So how frequent?
No, basically that all depends on how the resolver has been configured. Generally, okay. What happens is there is a TTL factor is there. So automatically that will be cleared off from its cache. And even if you send a query which is belonging to a older thing, it will be discarding, and again it will try to fetch from the newer one only. So if a resolver has been updated with the latest software, so what will happen is basically this automatic cache clearing will happen for a period of time. But that is quite a, so only issue is then we have to blame on the software which is being used for the DNS resolver.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
So next we will look at, so domain namespace is what is, it has been given by the DNS, and then name servers. Name servers are nothing but programs that hold information about the domain's tree structure. And then next is basically the resolvers. Resolvers are the programs that extract information from name servers to respond to client's request. Okay, so this is what is there. So as you can see in this diagram, DNS ecosystem, you may be querying for a particular domain name from your laptop or whatever mobile phone or whatever it may be, tablet or whatever. So the query goes to a resolver. Typically it is a recursive resolver. Okay. So if first it will try to find that particular resolution from its cache memory. If it is there, it will get the, give you the result. Otherwise, it will start with the root name server. Okay. It will start with the root name server, and then it will try to ask what is the IP address for the given domain name. Root name server will obviously point out to a corresponding the TLD, which, okay, whether it is based on, typically if it is country level or something like that, it will go to the CCTLD. So then after the CCTLD, it actually goes to the it will refer to the corresponding name server, that is secondary TLD. So it keeps going. So this is the process of resolution for a DNS query and response. So I hope everyone should be clear with this picture in mind. Basically, the query resolution starts with the root name server and then goes down until it gets the final authoritative name server for a given domain name, for a given domain name. Okay. So the stub resolver is basically your DNS client, and this always queries your recursive resolver RR, and RR will reply back to the stub resolver. Basically, as you can see in this previous image, that basically your stub resolver is nothing but a software program which asks for a DNS translation for a given domain name to IP address. Okay, so it is actually asking a resolver, and the resolver can be the resolvers which are operated by your ISPs, or it can be ones which are publicly operated by like Google 8.8.8 or something like that. Okay, so that is how it happens. So authoritative name server are the name servers which are supposed to give you the actual reply, that is the final translation of a given domain name to IP address. And say for example, for a coedns.security.in, there is one authoritative name server which will give you the response. Okay, and DNS hosting companies are the ones which typically manage the authoritative DNS servers for a domain name which the users query through the recursive resolvers. And master and slave configurations are also maintained to increase availability. Okay, so typically there will be multiple name servers, so one fails, then automatically another can be done. So this is why, this is the advantage of going to a professional DNS service provider than managing your own DNS name server for a given domain. So recursive resolver, we also called as a recursive DNS server. The user queries to the recursive resolver for a domain lookup, and RR queries the entire DNS hierarchy for the final result, and RR can also be authoritative for some domains. There are these are, when we talk about the DNS ecosystem, you can see that the from the bottom you could have seen the stub resolver, that is the client. So client queries a recursive DNS server, recursive DNS server queries a root DNS server, and root DNS after that it refers to authoritative name server. So after that you go and get the results from the authoritative name server. So root servers are labeled, they are special servers, they are labeled as A2M. And there are instances, that is copies of those name servers are there across the world. So that we'll see in a few moments of time. And authoritative name server, as I told you, that typically at least master and slave, two of the servers will be there for a given domain name if they are operated by a professional DNS service provider. So now just I want to ask you the question, what do you think actually, whether DNS is, you think as a centralized architecture or a decentralized architecture? Anyone can raise their hands and try to answer this. Yeah, I think this time we'll give it to, so many are there, we'll give it to Manish. Ask him.
Decentralized.
Okay. So any other answer, Vicky? Mr. Vicky.
Hello.
Yes, Mr. Vicky.
Yeah, it's decentralized.
Decentralized. Okay, fine. So Abhijit also wants to say something.
Yeah, it is centralized.
Centralized. Okay. So there is a different answer. Okay, fine then. So let me get back. So basically, as you can see that there is the administration is basically delegated. Okay. But in one way or the other, we are all tied to the root. Okay, so I cannot say that, okay, I can keep my name, my own name. Say, for example, I can keep a balaji.in or whatever it may be. Okay, but if I cannot say that I have to be tied up with something, okay, my that name Balaji, I can keep it as whatever I want, but I have to be tied up with some particular country name or another ccTLD or another level. Okay, and ultimately that particular country or whatever the generic TLD should be tied to the root. Okay, so that is the bond which is existing. Okay. You have freedom to keep or choose your name. You have the freedom to choose your authoritative name servers and things like that. But obviously, you are bound by a thin line of thread to the root actually. So if there is a cutoff from the root, obviously you will not be existing at all. Okay, so I cannot say like, I cannot have something like balaji.rajendran. I mean, there is no further after that. Okay, just I'm keeping a domain name like balaji.rajendran. That is not possible as of now. Okay, unless otherwise I have a gtld for Rajendran and I get it. So that is otherwise. So I am tied to the root in a way. So basically what we can say is, this is a decentralized architecture in the terms of administration and management. Okay. But in one way or the other, you are directly, you are having a line of thin line of control or visible, invisible line of control to the root. Okay. So this is what is there. So that we will see in a moment of time. So basically, I want to emphasize the importance of the root server here, DNS root server. They are the top of the DNS hierarchy and they contain the information of all the TLDs. Say, for example, tomorrow, let us say that we are proposing to have a new generic TTLD. Let us say we want to have a GTLD called DNS. Okay, and but nobody is agreeing for that, or the root is not agreeing. So that means if the root is not agreeing to have a generic TLD as a DNS, then obviously we cannot exist. Okay, so unless otherwise they accept it, we will not be able to have that one. Okay, so now this information, what are the TLDs, TLDs as well as the country level TLDs are the generic TLDs which are existing in this world that are maintained by 13 root name servers. 13 are there. Okay, so and they are named as A to M, that is A root server, B root server, C root server, up to M root servers, they are there. Okay, and they are maintained, and these 13 root servers are maintained by 12 different organizations that we will see a little later. And you have to most importantly note that these 13 are maintaining the same data. That is, whatever content is there in the A root server is also there in B, is also there in D, is also there in F, is also there in M. Okay, so they are not that the data is partitioned in some data is there in A, some data is in B, some data, it's not like that. Okay, all the data which is there in the A root server is also there in B, is also there in C, D, etc. So each root server is a copy and none of them are special. Okay, and one more thing is, these root servers are replicated across the world. Okay, that is, a copy of the A root server is there in several places in this world, a copy of the B root server is there in several places of the world. Okay, almost 1000 instances are existing across the world. So in India, we are having copies of D root server, E root server, F, L, I, J, K. So across the country at different locations. And these root server operations are provided by volunteer efforts by a very diverse set of organizations. So there may be a question here, why only 13 root servers, why not more? So that, for that we need to, I just need to give you a little bit of history here. So in the earlier days, when IPv4 was existing, routers used to fragment the packets. Okay, if the next hop receiver, the next hop receiver, next hop router cannot receive a certain packet beyond a certain size. But all IP protocol implementation should minimally support a packet size of 576 bytes, that is including 20 byte. Okay, so this was the rule. So any router should be able to handle a packet of size 576, that is basically 556 payload. That is, you discard the 20 byte header, then you are left with 556 bytes. Okay, so if you can design a packet which is of less than 556 bytes, it can be transmitted without fragmentation. Now, so, but obviously you can have a larger packet and get it fragmented and it can be reassembled. But if it is within 512, then obviously it will can go at as a single packet. Now, initially, as I was saying now, that A root server, as these root servers are named as A to M. That is the name of the A root server is A dot root server. Similarly, B dot root server, like that it was there. But now we are having a very standard name. But previously it was not like that. Every root server was having slightly varying names. Some of them were 15 bytes and some of them were 31 bytes, etc. Okay, so this was the original issue. But still considering that, but the varying these factors and all those things, and they found that the A record that we will come to know, so that can be any name server can be represented by 16 bytes. That is what they told average. So they figured out that only 14 name servers can fit in. That is 16 into 14 is basically, it should be less than 576. But they decided that they will stick with 13 root servers so that later future they can do add extensions and options. So 13 root servers are there. That is A to M is available and they are distributed across the world. So these are the 13 root servers, A to M. That is, which are located, this thing, as you can see, most of the servers are located in the Americas and few are in Europe and one in Japan. But copies of these 13 root servers are across the world. Okay, the instances or copies of these 13 root servers are across the world. Okay, so these are the root server operators, that is A to M, and their IP addresses and their operators. As you can see that VeriSign is actually operating both A root as well as J root. So that's why I told you that 13 root servers are operated by 12 operators. Okay. So I'm seeing a hand. So I'll Manish. Mr. Manish, you want to have a, you are having a question? You have raised your hand. Anybody else who wants? Any questions here at this point regarding the 13 root servers? Okay, so let me proceed. Yes, Mr. Manish, you want to say something?
No, no, sir.
Okay. So in India, these are the distribution of the root servers. So you can see the distribution of the copies. There is the copies of the E root server, F root server is in Chennai, and copy of J root is in Bangalore, Kolkata, J and L, Delhi, J, K and F. Mumbai, you have all, almost all, D, E, F and I, J, K, L, all are there. So these are the root servers. So maintainer, as far as the root server maintainers, actually NIXI is maintaining 3 and Verisign is maintaining J, and other organizations like ISOC, they are maintaining one in Kolkata. So this is some of the operators of this one. Okay, there is a query here from Ms. Samiksha. Yes, Samiksha, please go ahead. Ms. Samiksha, you are having a query?
Are you able to hear me?
Yeah.
Sir, here we are maintaining a replica at multiple location. So, yeah. How they select the location?
No. Location is, nobody selects it. Tomorrow you can also operate from the place wherever you are. So there is, but generally as a country wise, if you, it is being distributed in the places where there are a concentration of people who are using the internet, then basically it is good. So basically, you know that the top cities in the country definitely requires an instance of the root name servers, because the resolution will be faster. So obviously it will be better to hold there. So there is no hard and fast rule, it should be there or here. Basically the logic is that if a root server is being operated at a root server copy, that is root server copy is being operated at a place where there is going to be a lot of people using the internet, then that is the best place to keep.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
So, you may be worrying how much queries are really going, because as I said, in the DNS hierarchy, the most of the queries are resolved in the cache itself, but some of the queries also keeps going. But as you can see, that this is a screenshot from the A root query server. So A root server is actually receiving this many millions of queries per day. Okay, so what I want to say is most of the queries are at least you are receiving millions of queries even at the root server level. So this is one thing which everyone needs to understand. So these are the following record types of the DNS thing. So when you have a A record, where A record tells you the what is the IP address of a given domain. So FQDN means fully qualified domain name. Fully qualified domain name is called FQDN. So whatever a given domain name, it actually is translated to a IP address by the A record. Then basically NS record is there. NS record will tell you what are the authoritative name servers for a given domain or a zone. Then next to that is basically TXT record. TXT record is a type of a resource record that associates arbitrary text with your host, and this can be used for verification and email validation. The next important record is basically a MX record. MX record is, say, for example, when you are sending a mail to somebody, okay, that let us say Balaji at cdac.in or something like that. So then obviously there needs to be a resolution for that CDAC.in to be figured out. Okay. So MX record, what they will tell you is they will tell you the another record, they will refer to another A record where you will get the IP address of the domain name. So basically they will not give you the what is the IP address of CDAC.in. Instead, they will point to the A record, which will actually give the IP address for that CDAC.in. So this is what happens in the MX record case. Next is the PTR record, there is a pointer record we see. So if this record is there, it will be very good to do a reverse translation. Suppose if there is an IP address and if you want to get translated to your domain or host name, then this will be a PTR. And this should be separately configured and hosted. Okay, so this is the point. And there are three query types that we can see which will happen. One is a recursive query, another is iterative query, and third is a reverse query. Okay. So let us see the illustration of a recursive query. That is basically your resolver. It starts with your resolver asking your DNS server. Okay, that is your client resolver, client machine or whatever it is, that is actually asking a DNS resolver what is the resolution for the given domain name. So then the DNS resolver, let us say that it is not having in its cache, it will ask the root name server. And let us say that root name server does not have the data, so it goes on the behalf of your DNS resolver and asks the next level TLD. And then if it has asked the TLD goes and asks the next level STLD, and then it goes to the authoritative DNS server and gets the answer back. And if this is traversing back like this, then this is what we call it as a recursive query. But practically, this is not possible and feasible. Okay. So what will happen typically is it will actually be an iterative query which will happen. So let us see that in the iterative query, your browser or a machine is actually asking for a resolution of a given domain name to the DNS resolver. The DNS resolver asks the root name server. Root name server says, I don't know, but you go and ask the next level TLD. Okay. So the next level TLD responds with saying that I also don't know, you go and ask the authoritative name server for the given domain. So then authoritative name server responds with the required IP address. So this is how the process happens in an iterative query. So you can see that the resolver is named as a recursive resolver. That is basically it operates in a recursive way. It first goes and asks the root server. Root server responds with something. Then after that, it goes and asks for the TLD, and then it further asks for the STLD and things like that. So it operates in a recursive way, but the rest of the things are all iterative queries. The query is basically one iteration is going on. So this is how it is. So in reality, so your browser will ask a recursive resolver to resolve a given domain name, and it is up to the resolver to make several iterative queries to the different servers, root server, from starting from root name server to the authoritative name servers, and get the responses. Okay. This is what is there. And reverse lookup is what happens when you try to translate a TLD, sorry, when you translate a IP address to a domain name. So now here also the same kind of structure is followed. So now what will happen is when you do a reverse lookup, you are giving an IP address. So when you are giving an IP address, first of all, the root is queried. The root, finding that this is an IP address, says that you go and ask something called dot ARPA. Okay, this is a name server which is there, TLD name server which is existing for doing reverse query. So it says that you go and ask the dot ARPA name server, which will give you the translation of this IP address to a domain name. So now ARPA will first of all have to find out whether this is IPv4 address or IPv6 address. If it is IPv6 address, it will say that you go and ask IP6.ARPA. Okay, and further, if then it will, let us assume that for the moment it is IPv6 address. So you again, then your resolver goes and asks the IP6.ARPA. So that will probably give you the actual translation, that is IPv6 translation of this particular address to the domain name. Now, if it is not IPv6 query, but it is IPv4 query, then ARPA will refer you to in, that is in -addr.arpa TLD server. So your resolver have to go and ask the in addr.arpa resolver. So that will actually refer to, meaning after successive progressions, it will give to a authoritative name server that will give the translation of your IP address to domain. Okay, but please remember that I just introduced you to record types, DNS record types. So when you are configuring your DNS for your domain name, let us say coedns.security.in is your domain name. When you are configuring it, you have to configure not only the A record, of course the NS record and things like that, but also if you are configuring the PTR record, that is the pointer record, then only you'll be able to do a reverse translation. If PTR record is not there, then you will not be able to do a reverse translation. Okay, so it is also important to note that it is a very good practice and a healthy one to have a PTR record for a given domain name. So that increases the acceptance of your domain name, the genuinity of your domain. Okay, so this is what is there as far as this one. So yeah, there is a question from Anup Pandey. Yes,
sir. Just now you told the process of this reverse resolution. Mm. Now the reverse lookup zone is also created in the authoritative DNS server.
Mm.
But the hierarchy that you showed that is going to ARPA and then from ARPA it is going to inaddress.arpa. So how does it reach to our authoritative DNS server where pointer record is there? How will it get that record?
Yeah. So this actually starts with the ARPA, and then basically the first classification is easier. That IPv4 or IPv6 classification is easier. Further to that, it is not directly 68.189.156.220, that is not is going to happen. It will actually be a division of the octet by octet, that is byte by byte, basically significant will happen. So slowly it will reach to a level where it will actually go and reach the correct authoritative name server, which can provide you the reverse translation of this one. Obviously, this diagram does not capture the step-by-step going and reaching the exact domain because the number of traversals are more. So let us say in the case of INADDR to ARPA, at least it has to traverse to four further TLDs to reach to the exact translation of the IP address to the domain name.
No, but that reverse lookup zone is in our authoritative server.
Your so authoritative zone, but you are only having a PTR record that will provide you the reverse translation where you enter the value, that is reverse value you are entering in the PTR record.
Anup, Sanjay here.
Yes, sir.
See, what is happening here, whatever you are telling that we have authoritative DNS server where we have a reverse lookup entry. Now that entry is not valid till you are using it or it is announced to your parent zone, right? If you are announcing to parent zone, then only that entry will be valid. Otherwise, it is no use. So that parent zone is nothing actually. It will be one octet of IP address, right? And that octet will tell actually whether your particular authoritative server is part of our octet or not.
Okay, so that is how the hierarchy goes.
Exactly. Yes. So basically, every level of octet has to be will be authorized to do it. So further as you come down, you will be able to reach to the exact location where you can find the PTR record.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
So, as I said that there are public DNS recursive resolvers which are available. So, we are also operating a public resolver. We suggest you to use this one. And we have both IPv4 as well as IPv6 resolve is being used here. You can configure it. Today, most of the mobile phones are having a private DNS facility where you can directly enter the resolution, or at least you can enter this as our secondary thing. Because if some of the resolvers are failing, let us say which are operated by the ISPs are failing, then probably you can use it as a backup thing. You can configure this one as a secondary resolver for your this thing. Because this you will, I have noticed a lot of failures. So instead of relying on a single resolver, you can actually configure multiple resolvers. And then our resolver is actually compliant with RFC 7706. What does it mean is, whatever queries you are asking, let us say that you are asking for a new query like dnssecurity.in. So that means that this entire dnssecurity.in does not go to the root name server. Okay. It basically, we have a copy or mirror of data, whatever the data root means is contained, we are having a copy of it within our resolver. So the speed of resolution is slightly faster, okay, from here. So these are the public DNS resolvers available across the world. And as you can see that US is operating 1,000 plus public DNS resolvers, and India around 100 plus resolvers are there. And within India, of course, the distribution is something like this. Bangalore is having 7 and things like that. And most of the cities are having at least most of the important cities have 1 or 2 resolvers. Of course, except for the cities like Mumbai, Hyderabad, Chennai, etc. So, as you can see, the number of DNSSEC is a very important feature, which we'll be discussing tomorrow. But as you can see that here, the number of DNS resolvers which are DNSSEC enabled are very less. You can only see few resolvers. I mean, of course, whatever resolvers are there in Bangalore, they have been fully DNSSEC enabled. But rest of the things you can see, they have not been enabled. So the awareness of DNSSEC is very much required. So this is one of the important thing. So before I end my session, I thought we would like to draw your attention to this. So you know that this is a COVID-19 world, and almost 136,000 new domains have cropped up with the theme of COVID-19, and most of them are found to be malicious. So most of them try to say the corona related viral maps and convenient mobile maps for tracking, advertising, mal advertising, fostering panic in, through disinformation. All those things have been happening. And we have been just tracking out the number of domain names that are registered under this theme with the .in domain name. We found 1,000 of them are registered. So of this 1,000 plus, we found 700 to be malicious. 700 of the domain names were found to be malicious domain names. So we request people to be very careful. And moreover, when you are reading a domain name in your browser, start reading from the right. Okay. So let us say that I think this is a very quite a well-known example. Let us say that if somebody says sbi.coedns.security.in, you are not really speaking with server in State Bank of India, but you are actually speaking with the coedns security server. Okay. But if you are, let us say that it is the other way around. coedns.security.sbi.co.in, then obviously you are speaking with a server which is of which is in SBI. Okay, so obviously you should start reading the domain names from the right hand side, that is the ending point, that is .in means India. From next to that, what is that you need to see? So this way you will be able to figure out, meaning this is not a foolproof method, but at least to a certain extent you can do. You have to do further digging up and things like that. So there is a question here. Is anybody having a question here?
So before we go to actually next session of configuration,
yeah,
if any question.